Good evening. Welcome to Our Lady of You or Not. On this, the Solemnity of the Body and Blood of Christ. My name is Mike, and I'm always serving as your cantor tonight. So I just want to go over what music we're going to be doing, maybe get through a few hymns to help us warm up. So tonight we're going to start with the Gavin hymn, which for those of you here in the church is number 433. At the Land's High East, we sing. We'll just go through the refrain on that. Real quick.
Our celebrant this evening is our pastor, Father Risdorfer. Please stand and join in our opening hymn.
Our gathering hymn is number 433 in the gather book. At the Lamb's High Feast, we sing.
Thank you. We just celebrated the Feast of the Eucharist on Holy Thursday, not too many weeks ago. So there's something about this mystery, something about the body and blood of Christ and the sacrament of Christ about us that was so important. The church said, no, you have to pull it out of that three-act play called Holy Week and give it its own full magical event. It's a central mystery of faith. Jesus, the sacrament, comes here on our altars in the real presence, and it enters us as food. And it's through that food that he is the bread of heaven. Anyone who eats this bread will live forever. So as we come together as God's family, with confidence in us, ask God for forgiveness, for she is full of gentleness. Lord Jesus, you raise us to new life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you forgive us our sins. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you feed us with your body and blood. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us sing praise.
A reading from the book of Genesis. In those days, Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine, and being a priest of God Most High, he blessed Abram with these words. Blessed be Abram by God Most High, the creator of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who delivered your foes into your hand. Then Abram gave him a tenth of everything. The word of the Lord.
This is the sequence before the gospel. Lo, the angel's food is given to the pilgrim who has striven. See the children's bread from heaven, which on dogs may not be spent. Truth, the ancient types fulfilling. Isaac bound, a victim willing. Paschal lamb, its lifeblood spilling. Manna to the fathers sent. Very bread, good shepherd, tend us. Jesu, of your love, befriend us. You refresh us, you defend us, your eternal goodness send us in the land of life to see. You who all things can and know, who on earth should such food bestow. Grant us with your saints, though lowest, where the heavenly feast you show, fellow heirs and guests to be. Amen. Alleluia.
Please stand.
He said to them, "Give them some food yourselves." They replied, "Five loaves and two fish are all we have, unless we ourselves go and buy food for all these people." Now the people there numbered about 5,000. Then he said to his disciples, "Have them sit down in groups of 50. They did so, and made them all sit down. Then, taking the 5 loaves and 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he said the blessing over them, broke them, and gave them to the disciples to set before the crowd. They all ate and were satisfied. And when the leftover fragments were picked up, they filled 12 wicker baskets." This is the good news of the Lord. Praise be to you, Lord.
I said to Stacy, I kept wondering why this owl felt awfully long. I'm touching the trivial. Turns out, she's 4 inches wide, which is taller than me. A stumble of fall. Tonight, as I said, we celebrate
This annual feast draws our focus to the sacrament of Christ's living presence among us. The sacrifice of the Mass, where we consecrate bread and wine, transforming it to the living bread that came down from heaven. Of this bread, the Lord Jesus said, whoever eats this bread will live forever. It is the sacrament that prevents Jesus as the perfect sacrifice. As the cup of wine is separated from the bread, we focus on how Jesus literally bled out on the cross for us as a sacrifice. Just as the sacrificial animals on the altars of the old temple in Jerusalem, these temple altars were made to God to show that all the people had come from God. They acknowledged God's supremacy over all creation and were offered back to Him in gratitude. But these sacrifices, these old sacrifices of the temple, were earthly and therefore imperfect. And thus needed to be done over and over and over and over again, because they fell short of a sacrifice worthy of the perfect God. Our sacrifice is that of God's only Son and God Himself. It is therefore perfect. Because He is God, this sacrifice is the sacrifice in all sacrifices. Jesus was not just a prophet coming to give us new wisdom and teaching. He came to be the perfect offering for us. In giving His life as God made human, the act of praise and worship was perfect. All of our acts, praise and worship, were perfect. As He is the perfect victim representing all humanity, the debt of sin was erased, and we are again restored as full heirs to the kingdom of heaven. Our sacrifice is also a remembrance. As Paul says in today's letter to the church in Corinth, which has gone through one heck of an amount of turmoil at the time, guess what they were doing? They were telling some people church, they weren't worthy of communion, Paul says that the Lord Jesus, on the night He was handed over, took bread, and after He had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, He also took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until He comes," says Paul. In every Eucharistic prayer, we follow Paul's exhortation with words such as, "Therefore, Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of our redemption, we remember Christ's death and His descent into the realm of the dead. We proclaim His resurrection and His ascension to your right hand. And we await His coming in glory. We offer you His body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you, which brings salvation to the whole world." That's called the anamnesis of the Mass. It's a Greek word that means the remembrance. The sacrifices that were offered in the temple were consumed by the altar. The altar was killed, cut to pieces, and then burned until nothing was left but ashes. The smoke of its destruction was thus left only to God. Our Jesus was also killed, but He left us the sacrament to remember Him, so that God can become one with us do so to another. Self-emptying love, by the way, is the message of his gospel about that mirror of the loaves and the fishes. It's the only one of Christ's miracles other than the resurrection that occurs in every gospel. In fact, it occurs six times in four gospels. And it's referred to indirectly in other places five other times. So it begs the question, what was so memorable about that miracle on the hill that is stuck in the minds of the early Christian community so strongly? I would suggest that it was this miracle in which the apostles saw for themselves how powerful selfless love is. Selfless love is shown by Jesus. They saw that he can change hearts and thus change the world. It was this miracle that the apostles first experienced for themselves what it meant to work on Jesus' behalf in the conversion of souls. Because it was they who performed the miracle. Some fundamentalists and liberals from the scriptures would have us believe that after having the 5,000 reclining groups of 50 on the hillside, somehow Jesus took this basket of five loaves and two fish and magically made more and more and more and more appear until they were all fed. I don't know. I'm certain that God could have done that. Maybe that's indeed what happened. I don't think so. I think what Jesus actually did was quiet and undramatic, but astoundingly miraculous. I think he proclaimed his death, his dying to himself. He put aside his own means and thus showed others how to do likewise, how to die and live to themselves. I mean, they were, after all, in the middle of nowhere, a deserted place, the scripture says. When the disciples asked, how do we provide for all these people? What does Jesus say? You feed them. You give them something. The English translation doesn't quite get it right. In the original Greek, that word you is the emphatic force. You give them something. Not me. He asked me for. You do. Recall that the apostles had just returned
from a very long,
very long mission. Jesus had sent them off to preach his word to the villages, and they probably didn't have the opportunity to replenish their food supply. All they had were these fish and a few loaves of bread. Jesus nonetheless takes these few meager items, blesses them, and asks the disciples to share. To go against your own interests, and instead be totally generous to others. So that's what they did. They showed selfless love and compassion for others, even if it meant they no longer themselves. Now in those days, unlike today, the landscape was not punctuated with fast food outlets every 1,000 feet or so. No one in their right mind in those days would have left home without taking provisions in return. No one had something in their satchels or in their cloaks, something to eat, something to drink. And it was dangerous. It was for them. Every man for himself. And it was every man.
selfless and embarrass the people of that day. Perhaps moved by human compassion, and they actually reached into their provisions and started to share as well. And this was played forward over and over and over again, and guess what happened? In the crowd, now converted into a generous community of love, there was enough to feed everyone and create 12 baskets of leftovers. I ask you, what was the greater miracle? To have loaves and fishes magically multiply, or to convert the hearts of 5,000 people to be lovers? What was the miracle that was more likely a sign of our love? And naturally, being good at being appreciated once. Jesus challenged the disciples to give the people something to eat, making them his partners in the miracle. And they made everyone in the crowd partners in the miracle. Willingness of the disciples to trust Jesus and follow his examples was to this miracle just as our trust and obedience is key to his kingdom today. Christ takes our contribution, however modest, and makes it miraculous. You give him something. Continues to challenge all of us Christians today. We live in a world full of hungry people, and pray that Jesus might do something for them. But he responds, you give them something. You do something for them. You care for them. You care for them. You heal the sick. You care for the blind. Not me. You, my followers, my trusted friends. That is the miracle of the Eucharist. By it, Jesus comes to us, enters into us, and challenges us to proclaim his death by dying to ourselves. Self-sacrifice is hard. It's not easy. That is why this sacrament is also nourishing. Eucharist is not a reward for being good, as some Roman clergy would have us believe. It's fuel to give us the strength that we need to convert. God, who is the sustainer of all existence, so loved us, so loved his creation that he took the form of his creation and became one of us. And all through his life, he showed us that the path to true happiness is one of love for others. And that love, in all cases, means to forgo one's own pleasure, one's own power, one's own priorities, one's own success for others. It's a path that calls us to be willing to give it all for God and neighbor. In other words, to be like Jesus, we need to be a sacrifice for others, as he was. When Jesus tells us to die of ourselves, to love God with our whole self, our whole mind, and all of our resources, to sell all we have and give to the poor. That's one heck of a commitment. It is in his example of dying on the cross that shows how intense he views that. Just as he did, we're to hold nothing back, even to the point of dying ourselves. When at the Last Supper, Jesus blesses the bread and says, this is my body, and blesses the cup of wine, and says, this is my blood, and then looks at the disciples and says, do this in memory of me. The this that he's speaking about is not just blessing the bread and wine, he's referring to acting as sacrifice as he sacrificed. That's the this. And that is why at our communion, I present the bread of life and say, I am Christ. Receive who you are, be what you receive. We are to give Jesus to the world, and that's how we live in the remembrance. Finally, we focus on the sacrament as a mystery. We're not to be nourished by God for our own sake. We are to be nourished by God in order to join the larger body of Christ, the mystical body of Christ. We become the church. We are to actively participate in its life and its growth. We are the living body of the Lord Christ in this day and age, here and now. And the mission that he began when he was here is now for us to bring to fruition. To do that, he becomes our food so that we can follow his examples and offer the sacrifice of ourselves as well. He literally gets into our hands. The mystery of the Eucharist is for us to live lives of sacrifice for others, service to our God, which Jesus himself did, to be united with him in the being of the world. That's his offer. That's the deal. That's the new covenant that God invites us to enter as we come home with him and partake of the food of the universe. It's a covenant sealed in Christ's blood. Frankly, sealed with our honor. Let us give thanks and praise to the Lord for the gift of himself he has provided to us in the universe. Let us give thanks and praise for the sacrifice that he offered when his blood was separated from his body on the cross and bled out onto the earth for all of us. Let us give thanks and praise for the example of his life and death and resurrection and for the nourishment of being physically united with him through the Eucharist. The word Eucharist, after all, means thanksgiving. Thanksgiving, after all. That's the reason we come together this night. Body and blood of Christ gives us all we need to grow the church. Shows us the depth of sacrifice that we are called to give. As we receive this body and blood tonight, I will remind you again, this is the body of Christ, who sees who you are and who you receive. Because of the moment that we have. You stand and join in confessing our faith. We believe in one God, Father, Almighty,
Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God of God, light of light, true God, begotten of the Father, for us, our first salvation, we thank you, our heaven, but our first superior, born and born to bear, and never became you.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For the people of Ukraine, that God will protect them, especially the most vulnerable, and peace restored, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we pass the 6th anniversary of the Pulse nightclub shooting, and for all those affected by the 20 mass shootings since Valverde, including
yesterday
at St. Stephen's Episcopal Church in Fiesta Hills, Alabama, where 3 were killed, and that our country will find the moral courage to eliminate this slaughter, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we commemorate Juneteenth, we pray that we will deepen our appreciation for our own freedoms and be thankful for those who served our country in the past and for those who currently serve to protect us, especially those stationed far from home, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for an end to hatred, violence, oppression, and war everywhere, starting in our own neighborhoods, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for families, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all those who are homeless and without food and shelter here in our own land, and across the world, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We lift up to you, Lord, the prayers and concerns that we hold in our hearts, as well as those prayers that have been asked of your mother, Our Lady of Lourdes. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Mike Schmidt's friend Maureen and Tom Calder's mom, for Frank Fox, Bishop Ron Stevens, Donna, Bill Payton, Sammy and David Williams, for Danny, for Anna, and General Robert Scales, for baby Crew Miller, Annie McGuire, for baby Vincent Michael, and David Cummings, for Scott Trees, Dave Horn, John Fox, Ryan Gamber, Bobby Stone, for the Gallagher family, Augustine and Jolene Guzman, and their families, for the Staley family, and for Yolanda Laraca. Let us pray for all those who are ill and in need of healing. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us raise up to God's embrace all those who have died, especially the firefighter who lost his life in Philadelphia yesterday, that they all may rest eternally in his presence. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For whom or what else shall we pray this evening?
Thanksgiving, of course, special thanks.
For the life of Ivy Brown, the family in the parish of Homilist.
For the life of Mike Harland and for family in the parish of Homilist. And for the dad, that's my dear and his father's friends.
For all those celebrating Father's Day, and for all fathers that are still here with us, and for those that aren't. Lord, we ask for your prayers.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father, we are grateful for all the many blessings. We have petitions we bring you this day. For your compassion, lift up those who are in need. We ask this in Jesus'
name. Amen. Amen.
Please join in singing of our offertory hymn, number 601 in the Gathered Book, All That We Have. Again, that's number 601.
they signify. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Father, all powerful and ever living God, we will always and everywhere to give you thanks. Today, you sent the Holy Spirit.
Servants of God. Advocates of Capitol and the New Capitol, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession we rely for help. Lord, may the sacrifice which has made our peace with you advance the peace and salvation of all the world, strengthening in faith and love of the Lutheran Church on earth, for Serving Francis, the Patriarch of Rome, our Bishops Barry and Lumen, all the bishops and all the clergy, and the entire people your Son has gained for you. Father, give prayers for the family who gathered before you. In mercy and love, unite all your children wherever they may be. Welcome into your kingdom our departed brothers and sisters, and all of us left this world in your virtue, especially for those of us whose fathers have passed on. We hope to enjoy forever the vision of your glory through Christ our Lord, from whom all good things come.
Please join me in singing our communion hymn, number 832 in the Gathered Book. Let us break bread together. Again, that's number 832. ask for peace in Ukraine. May all the people of that country, especially the weak and infirm, the children and elderly, remain safe from danger. We pray also for the aggressors, heal the blindness of every Russian leader and soldier, so that they might see plainly the evil of their cause and be filled with the courage to lay down their weapons and go home. We pray for all those who have not had us far, or stop continuing. Do not let the chaos, brutality, and evil of war reign in Ukraine, but only a forever peace that comes from you. Pray for us. Full of grace. The Lord is with thee. Bless our God, most women. Bless us with the fruit of our bodies. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for our sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hallelujah, sing to Jesus. That's number 853.